Dear colleagues, warm welcome to everybody to the fourth live webinar. The topic today is the intranodular hyperechoic figures. The essence of this theme is indeed the differential diagnostics of microcalcification, which is one of the most important suspicious signs of a papillary cancer. First, I give a brief summary of these features in 15 minutes, then we turn to the joint analysis of 7 related cases. Before turning to the subject, I would like to draw attention to the importance of the warning that has been said also in the previous meeting. As we will see, the discrepancy between investigators is also very significant in the assessment of microcalcifications. So my opinion is obviously debatable and should be debated, similarly to all other interpretations. So this presentation briefly summarizes of the pre-recorded video and manual presented in the website. I highlight 3 themes. There are 7 or 8 different forms of intranodular echogenic figures. The first 2 are essentially the same and are related to the normal architecture of the thyroid, the spider web-like network composed of connective tissue. The next 2 subtypes were discussed 2 weeks ago. These are related to cystic degeneration. The next 2 are the 2 forms of calcifications. Finally, there are special forms which are rarely mentioned in the literature. These are the amyloid deposit and the granulation around surgical thread. In most cases, we did not realize and did not notice the presence of pale echogenic lines and granules, which correspond to the connective tissue network of the thyroid. The presentation, whether the granular or linear form prevails, depends on the angle between the ultrasound wave and the connective tissue. This form of intranodular echogenic figures have no clinical or differential diagnostic relevance. The echogenic lines and granules became brighter if the echogenicity of the thyroid decreases, mainly in Hashimoto's thyroiditis, but also in Graves' disease. A real concern arises if these bright granules and lines are within a nodule, which occurs in around 5% of hypoechoic nodules. In such cases, the differentiation from microcalcification can be difficult or even impossible. The next form is the comet tail artifact, which has been already discussed for 2 weeks. I emphasize here only the main concern. Comet tail artifacts quite frequently lack the characteristic tail and can occur within solid parts of a cystic nodule, but the differentiation from microcalcification is a real concern. The next figure is caused by posterior acoustic enhancement, dorsal to cystic areas. The backward figures were also discussed 2 weeks ago. Now I turn to the microcalcification, which seems to be the public enemy or the feature which we hunt in nodular goiter patients. The terminology is not uniform. In the European thyroids, the term true microcalcification is used and is restricted to unequivocal forms of microcalcifications. The ACR thyroids introduced a new term, the punctate echogenic foci, which is more appropriate to describe hyperechogenic granules, because we cannot exclude the possibility that behind a bright hyperechogenic nodule, not microcalcification exists, but other structures. For example, dense structures where the cellularity is extremely high, for example, in the tip of a hyperplastic benign papilla, it can project it also as microcalcifications. These are bright echogenic granules, not larger than 1 millimeter in maximal diameter. The presence of microcalcification clearly increases the likelihood of papillary cancer to almost 7 times. These forms of echogenic figures are found in a wide range depending on the interpretation of the authors, and can also be found in benign lesions with much less frequency. The huge difference in the incidences reflects the significant difference in the interpretation. Microcalcifications should be differentiated from other types of granular hyperechogenic bright forms, mainly from commetial artifacts, connective tissue, and also from granular form of Becquerel cystic figures. The other form of calcification is the coarse or macrocalcification. These can be present in goiters large, which are found from decades, and can be the form of a normal degenerative process. Nevertheless, coarse calcification also increases the likelihood of malignancy, but to a much lesser extent than, for example, microcalcification. The hallmark of a coarse calcification is not the primary focus of the calcification, but the dorsal acoustic shadow caused. It defines the presence of coarse calcification irrespectively of the presence or the lack of the calcified focus. We have two special forms which are rarely mentioned in the literature. Amyloid deposit is the first one. It is characterized by an econormal or hyperechoic patch of several millimeters or even 1 centimeter in maximal diameter, and these econormal patches have punctate echogenic foci. This is the ultrasound presentation of amyloid. I have found this sign very useful in the diagnosis of medullary cancer, but only two or three similar publications can be found in the thyroid literature. Nevertheless, if we see a cotton-like echogenic patch in a hypoechoic nodule, we should perform serum calcitonin determination. The last figure is indeed not an intranodular echogenic figure, but I mentioned here. It has a very special appearance, this granulation around surgical thread. It can appear even decades after a surgical procedure. This is characterized by a hypoechoic mass, which has irregular shape. It is always avascular. And within this hypoechoic background, we can see econormal areas with bright echogenic granules. The hallmark or the clue is the patient history. It can occur even decades after the surgery, and decades after the surgery, not infrequently, patients forget about this previous surgical intervention. And if we are not aware about this history, we can misinterpret such hyperechoic masses as suspicious of thyroid cancer. Indeed, there are five types of intranodular hyperechoic figures which we have to deal with. I classified in this table in another way, corresponding to their ultrasound presentations. If we see synchronous lines and granules, these hyperechoic figures are either proliferation of connective tissue or Becquerel figures. These figures have minimal, if any, oncological importance. The differentiation depends on the presence of cystic areas ventral to the hyperechoic lines. The second form is characterized by the presence of granules. Commetial artifacts and microcalcifications belong to this subgroup. A microcalcification is characterized by the dorsal acoustic shadow. So let's see the role of these intranodular hyperechoic figures in the various thyroid systems. The only one is the Korean Tyrants, which mentions comet tail artifacts, and this system has a very strong argument. If we see comet tail artifact, the nodule should be grouped among benign lesions irrespectively of all other potentially suspicious signs. The Korean Tyrants is right because comet tail artifact significantly decreases the risk of malignancy. Nevertheless, the possibility cannot be fully excluded. No other Tyrants shares this view of the current Tyrants. Microcalcifications are mentioned in the three American Tyrants systems. The ATA states that if we see a rim calcification with excessive soft tissue component, then this is a very suspicious sign. Nevertheless, it is a very rare finding. A typical form is found in less than 1 to 1,000 of thyroid nodules, so the importance of such finding is much less than, for example, the finding of a microcalcification. The ACR Tyrants states that if we see any form of macrocalcification, it is worth 1 point, and if this is a peripheral type rim calcification, then 2 more points should be added to the calculation. It means that if we see a macrocalcification, the lesion is at least a Tyrants 3. If we see a peripheral rim calcification, the lesion should be classified at least as Tyrants 4 lesion. The AECE Tyrants also mentions the presence of macro or continuous rim calcification. Nevertheless, this does not influence the categorization of the nodule according to these Tyrants. Neither the Korean nor the European Tyrants mentions and involves coarse calcification into their systems. So the issue is, and the matter is, the microcalcification. According to the AACE and the European Tyrants, if we see microcalcification, the lesion should be classified as high suspicion lesion. In the three other systems, the classification of a nodule containing microcalcification depends whether the nodule is hypoechoic or not. These systems, mainly the ATA and the Korean systems, have an other approach compared to the former two Tyrants system. Nodule can only be high suspicion lesion if it is hypoechoic. This is a quite difficult to read table. I emphasize here only the lowest role. According to around 10 publications in the literature, benign lesion has a 4% chance having microcalcifications, while a malignant nodule has around 50% chance to have microcalcifications. The wide range reflects the huge inter-observer variability. In the event of benign nodules, it is a 15-fold difference between the lowest and the highest rate, and regarding malignant nodules, it is around a 5-fold difference. It also influenced by the presence and by the rate of non-papillary cancers within the malignant lesions. If we see only or mainly or more or almost exclusively papillary cancers, then the rate of microcalcification is high. If our cohort contains also follicular cancers, then the rate is much lower. And this is the final table, or final but one table. We can see that microcalcification is a specific feature of papillary and also of medullary cancer. In medullary cancer, in fact, we did not see calcification on the histopathological analysis, but similar forms which are very similar to microcalcifications can be found in almost the same rate. Around 50% of medullary and papillary cancers have microcalcifications. In contrast to these two forms, these two subtypes of thyroid cancers, follicular cancer almost always lacks microcalcifications. So similarly to all other suspicious characteristics, follicular cancer behaves just the opposite as papillary and medullary cancer. How to describe and which form we should describe? I think that if we see a bright echogenic granule, we should describe in our medical report, even if it is a comet tail artifact. It has relevance in quality control and has relevance if the patient will be later examined by less experienced investigator. So I think that even in the event of comet tail artifact, it is worth describing. Macroclassification is also highly advised to describe. The forms of connective tissue can be abandoned in the medical report. It is very important how to describe an echogenic granule. I fully agree with the approach of the European thyroids, which states that we can describe microcalcification, we can describe this phrase on our medical report only in absolutely unequivocal cases. Many forms are not unequivocal. In such cases, we should present in our medical report our doubt or our uncertainty. We can use the phrase punctate echogenic foci or hyperechogenic granule, but should not state that we see microcalcifications if we are not fully sure in this. Finally, never forget that the goal of thyroid ultrasound is not to give a pathological diagnosis, not to make distinction between a benign or malignant nodule, but the goal of thyroid ultrasound is to diagnose a nodule and to make decision on finding the aspiration cytology. So this was the brief summary of the theoretical aspects of intranodular hyperechoic figures. And now we turn to the joint analysis of seven cases.